September the 27th, 2016. We'll now come to order, and we start with the Pledge of Allegiance. Marty, would you start us, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And I'd like to publicly thank Shada for the nice light spreaders. I think it looks really nice. Thank you. Okay. Did everybody have a chance to read the minutes from the last meeting? Any additions or corrections? I would entertain a motion then on the minutes.
So moved.
Move to approve.
Second?
Second.
Those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Very good. 6-0. Board of Works public safety minutes were passed along for information purposes only. Takes us down to our public, like to start our public hearing regarding the 2017 budget. Shada, I'll give you the floor for that.
Essentially, the proposed budget's been advertised as according to the DLGF, and this would be open to the floor for any questions or comments from the public to start with. Currently, our current proposed tax levy for 2017 is $2,677,481. The budget estimate for all funds, including non-taxed funds, is $6,876,670. So at this point, you can open the floor to the public if there's any questions, comments, concerns.
So do it. Floor is now open. Anyone have any questions or concerns regarding our 2017 budget? Council members, any comments? Okay, that being the case, entertain a motion to close the public meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Those in favor signify by raising your right hand. 6-0. Okay. Move on to communications. We have a concern regarding chickens in the city limits. Reference to the current ordinance that's on the books. Ordinance number 26-2000. And Sean Campbell is here to speak to that situation. Right, Sean? You're going to be the spokesman.
Lisa's going to be a spokesperson.
Okay.
He's giving up his rights.
If you would step up to the podium and before you start, identify yourself for the RTC and the newspaper, folks.
Okay. My name's Alisa Campbell, and as you alluded to, that's my husband, Sean. I do have some information that I wanted to give you. I have extras if anybody in the audience would like it. Copy. My stapler was a little weird, so I apologize for that. Probably already know, based on the fact that it's become the Campbells versus the city in the newspaper, we are asking for an ordinance to be written that allows hens of the quantity of your choice in the size of space that you choose, with the restrictions that you come up with, to be allowed within the city limits. As you'll see on the first page, I've listed some cities that currently already have backyard chickens allowed within city limits. There are several pages of information. I'm not going to go through all of that with you, but this project, and I'll call it a project because that's kind of how it started for our family, is outlined a little bit on the last page Justin Pearson is the FFA advisor and the ag teacher at the high school. And so if you get a chance, you can read through that, but it just explains why chickens are important to city kids, but also why it was important to our family at the time. Okay, and then really what I want to go through is this cute little acronym that I made up on page two. And I wrote out HENS, Health in City. And I did this all by myself, so I hope you're all very impressed. All right, so first of all, we're asking for hens, we're not asking for roosters. So there's been a lot of issues, complaints about noise being one of the main problems, and I assure you that they are not noisy animals. Next, the E, excrement and shells are high in nitrogen, and they do make excellent fertilizer for gardening, for flower beds, for those people that do vegetable planting. Again, no noise. We have neighborhood dogs, and living on the lake, we have a lot of ducks and geese that have caused a lot more noise than chickens would. And then, I'm not sure if anybody is aware or how many of you are aware, but I'm in charge of and have created a program called Kids Bridge. And it is a program that provides backpacks of food to underprivileged kids in our community every Friday. And currently over 50% of our students at the elementary and middle school level are on free and reduced lunches and breakfast. And because of that, they're going home at night and on the weekends. And in some cases, they are food anxious. They do not have food in their pantries or refrigerators. So providing them an outlet for raising chickens gives them a way to be self-sufficient in the production of eggs. So it's just another way of making our community sustainable, self-sustainable. We as a family are organic. I didn't write that because I wrote hormone-free and no antibiotics. So I know what's going into my chickens. I know what's coming out of my chickens, so I can control that. Chickens, unlike dogs and other animals, don't require discipline. You don't have to walk them. So it's entertainment for our family. They're simple to take care of. My kids were born with allergies. So again, knowing what's going into my food and what's coming out, I can control that. We are asking for hens. We're not asking for roasters or cookers or whatever the word is for those. We don't want meat birds. We don't want to have to worry about slaughtering animals within, you know, in our garage. The I, insects and bugs, ticks, spiders, grubs, everything that is a nuisance in yards. We're dealing with that by the chickens. They're taking care of that in our yard. And then this is a big one in my family. We sadly waste a lot of produce, whether it's from the kids not finishing their broccoli or the cantaloupe being too mushy. And now that's not an issue. The research that I've done shows that up to 7 pounds of food is recycled just through hens alone. Now, the article that I read did not talk about how many hens, so I don't know exactly, but it was interesting to find out. And since we've been dealing with hens, we don't throw any. I don't have to worry about composting that. So that's been a blessing to us. In third grade, my daughter was in Mrs. Weaver's class. She got exposed to farm life and she caught the bug. So she is currently a city girl who loves and can't wait to be on a farm someday. She is going into agricultural engineering is her hope. And this was a way for, as you see by the letter, for her to develop her experience in the agriculture realm. And so it's exposing my kids. I'm embarrassed to say that I was in my 40s before I realized that a chick didn't develop in an egg unless it was fertilized. I didn't know that you didn't just take the egg away and stick it in the refrigerator to make sure a chicken wasn't hatched. I'm embarrassed to say that, but I have learned an immense amount. And that's me. My kids are, on Google and searching and what do they eat and what do we, what can we do? And it's amazing. Again, we talked about the sustainability of our family and our community. Tasty and fresh, high in vitamins and calories, or vitamins and low cholesterol, saturated fat, they're low in. And then I noticed Christina alluded to a stray chicken or so running around. Well, my experience with chickens is they are a chicken. And whenever they hear a loud noise or I disappear from the scene, they follow me. Now, my chickens are contained, but when I work out in the yard, I have had them out with me. So that's what she was talking about in that article. So if you don't believe me, there's some, you know, everything you read on the web is true. So there's a couple articles here that you can look through. I did include a copy of the South Bend ordinance and the checklist that they use for people applying for hens. And I guess that's really about it. So does anybody have any questions or anything?
Do you have a sense for how many hens you think is reasonable? For say a family of five.
Well, we have six, and they produce 4 to 6 eggs a day. When, you know, mature. Mine are still young, so it's not very consistent. I don't think more than 6 is necessary for a family of, I mean, we're a family of 4. And we give eggs to my mother-in-law and to some of our organic friends because we still don't eat 5-6 eggs a day. But I don't think there's a, I think, like I said, 6 is probably enough. I don't know, they are pack animals. They like to be together. Pack isn't the right word. So 2 isn't enough, but 6 is probably plenty. So if that answers your question, Mart, anybody else?
How long have you been raising chickens?
Well, we're not really raising chickens, but we did start this spring. In March, my daughter got pullets and began, as Justin Pearson, I'll just read those last few paragraphs. Although Kennedy has achieved a high level, very high level, she felt that her SAE was limited. SAE stands for Supervised Agricultural Experience. She has never had the opportunity to test her entrepreneurial skills, as she had only had agricultural jobs. This all changed last spring when she purchased a small chicken house and a few hens. So she began it as a, she's earned her chapter degree, her local degree, her state degree, and now she's working on her national, excuse me, or I think they call it an American degree. So just since March.
I know I became aware of it through the incident with the dog and one of your chickens, which poses another question for me. What do your neighbors think of this? Obviously, well, one with a dog's a little uncomfortable.
Okay, so first of all, the article was incorrect. The dog is in our neighborhood somewhere, but I'm not exactly sure. She's a couple streets over. And her dog was loose and running around the neighborhood, and I was out working in the yard, and the dog got loose and came over and attacked her chicken. The chicken is, her name is Chicken Patty, and she is alive. So the article was incorrect, she didn't die. But apparently, before I called the police on the loose dog, she called the police. So my neighbors, as far as I'm concerned, or as far as I'm aware, not concerned, are all, I didn't come here today to be the Campbells against the city. This never was intended to be that way, but because of that incident, that's what it's turned into. So now we're having to defend our position. And we have a letter from our neighbor, signed from our neighbors, but that wasn't why I was here, so I didn't feel like it was important. None of our neighbors have a problem with our chickens. Our closest neighbor actually is Austin Shepherd, and it's still a good 100 yards from his house. So the chickens never stray within, you know, 20 feet from their coop. And our other, we have an empty lot, we have an alley, and then we have neighbors on the other side of the pond. So I think, Mayor, that the issue was brought up from the one neighbor because of her delinquency as far as taking care of her pet. So.
Anybody, any other comments?
So, one concern I would have is, you know, you have to generalize it not just on your household where you're located at, but if there's going to be city, then we have to consider the people that live downtown whose houses are very close together, whose yards are close together.
Sure.
And then what kind of an effect that will be. I read in one of the things there said that coops will be cleaned every day. I also realize how children can be when, I want a puppy dog, I want a puppy dog. Okay, you're going to take care of that puppy dog. It happens for 6 weeks, and then all of a sudden, okay, now we've got chickens there that aren't being taken care of. You know, I get upset enough when I see dogs on chains. I can see chickens being abandoned also. I think there's so much to be decided on even how we could go about attacking this problem that this isn't going to be an easy solution.
No,
it's not going to happen quickly.
And that's why I'm giving you this information to look at. I know Shada's been preparing or giving information to you from other places. I know that the Sentinel's done some research. Yeah, it's not a 10-minute fix. I get that. I saw whatever she wrote something about, there was a square footage allotment per hen in one of the towns.
One of the cities.
Yeah. So it's not a one size fits all necessarily.
And
I am in a different situation because didn't know we were considered city limits when there's a part that says suburban city. So I didn't know that there was a delineation between, you know, to me it's city and farm, so.
Well, it's twofold, actually. It doesn't only involve an ordinance, it involves zoning. And it's actually two government bodies who are involved here. City council can rule on the zoning or on the ordinance situation, but it takes the Area Planning Commission and the BZA then to work on the zoning part of it.
So the zoning needs to be changed to ordinance?
But that doesn't mean we just say it's not going to happen. And just because two bodies have to approve it, I don't think that's the reason to say, okay, we're going to throw it to the side.
No, but you go through two processes.
Yeah, and that's part of the it could take a while. And like you said, in town, I live in town where houses are a lot closer together. We don't have the luxury of being able to be 100 yards from your neighbor with a chicken coop. But if you write the ordinance right, you know, South Bend is 15 feet from all property lines. If we were to go 20 feet from all property lines, that would take out a lot of houses. A lot of properties wouldn't be able to have chickens. You know, if we're creative with how you write an ordinance, there's a way to make it work, in my mind.
Yeah, I guess there's talk about the two different groups that we've got. I think, is there a third one with the Homeowners Association of the Lake? I'm not sure what it is out there.
Maybe every section has their own, but we don't have a homeowners association where we're at, so I can't speak for any of the other.
It's the Lake Association.
That would
have nothing governing zoning on the Lake Association.
That's like a club.
We take it, you know, it's for taking care of the lake and the buoys and seeing how things go on the aquatic side. It would have nothing to do with zoning on property.
One less thing to worry about that.
Yeah, and just so you know, I've done some research, which included trying to find the minutes for the meeting in November of 2000 when the initial ordinance was put into place. And those we've not been able to find, or what we have found are very sketchy. But I was able to speak to two city council people from that era, Burns Beck, Rob Lowe, and Mayor Thompson. And all three of them had basically the same answer. It was the result of some incident in the city coming up with that ordinance. They didn't remember the exact instance.
What year?
2000. But they were sure it wasn't a horse, a cow, or a pig. It was chickens. And that instituted that initial ordinance. The other thing I did was call some of the cities around. Bloomington has 80,000 people and an animal ordinance control, not officer, department, who have more people in it than we have police officers. One of the concerns I would have, and it doesn't matter what the limitations are, somebody's got to control those. Somebody's got to go measure, somebody's got to issue the permits, somebody's got to go through a whole litany of things to make sure that you get the person who comes into town and doesn't realize they can't have 90 chickens in their backyard. These are all concerns I have, plus the fact that we're trying to clean Rochester up, to be very honest with you. I've made 4 calls Monday and 2 calls today, and that's a pretty typical week of people to clean up their yards, clean up trash, mow their yards, just try to do the right thing rather than pull out the statutory hammer and say, we can go fine you, we can go ticket you. Just trying to talk to people about moving our city forward. And I look at this as a regression.
I truly do not. If you look at the up-and-coming cities down around Indianapolis, you know, where I lived right after college, Broad Ripple's booming, Carmel, they all allow chickens. I'm not totally for this, but I'm not against it just because it's going to be a hassle. You know, it's since 2000, you know, 2000 there wasn't it wasn't as big to eat organic, to know what you're eating, all that stuff. In the last 5 years, that's skyrocketed. And that's what, I mean, when I lived in Broad Ripple, that's when they passed it while I was there. You know, within a year, I maybe saw a couple people that had them along the Monon Trail. I mean, I don't think, and when you pass an ordinance, you gotta assume that, you know, quite a few might do it just in case, so we're not
gonna be prepared,
not undermanned.
Yeah.
But I don't see all my neighbors getting chickens. And like John said, come winter when you have to take care of them every day, I don't think it's going to be much of an issue at all.
Well, and you also have, I mean, that's the opportunity you have also is single family dwellings. That's where you get to set the information that's allowed.
But how many, and I don't know this number, downtown, I mean, it seems to me like every other house is an apartment. And if the ordinance says if you're not landowner, you know, if you've got 2 people on one property, you can't do this because it's not your property. If that's in the ordinance, that takes out half the houses right there. And I mean, I think that this is something we should at least consider.
Well, you know, again, I did call around. Our competition around us for economic development, Plymouth, no. Warsaw, no. Culver, no. And there was a good discussion there with the city manager at Culver. They got a nice lake. We have a nice lake. And his comment was, we tried it years ago and it just does not work out when you've got people who have many dollars invested in lake property, per se, and they've got somebody who brings chickens in next door. That's not something your folks at the lake want to see, typically. So they did away with it. And then, of course, the other aspect is the control, the animal control people. Who's going to do that? We've got Kyle Perkins here. He's our animal control officer. You're a department of how many?
One.
And
how
I'm
many,
always
and
on
how
you
many
about
dogs and cats are you dealing with every day?
Well, I've got some monthly reports we can go on if you. I've got.
So, you know, before you discount it because it's going to be a hassle, think about what you're doing. you have dogs and cats that are not where they're supposed to be. They're chained to short leashes. I know it looks like it's more work, but like Mason said, I don't see everybody running out and buying themselves some chickens, and we're going to have a free-for-all running around the streets of Rochester.
And that may be, but Mayor Ellis, whom I respect quite a bit over at Bluffton, I saw him last week, and he said, just be very careful. He's in his fourth term, so he's seen everything. He said, just be very careful that you remember and realize that ordinances have to be written for the majority, not just a few people, because he says it becomes a slippery slope. That's just this mayor's opinion of the situation, and I'm charged with helping move this community forward, and that's just my look at it.
Mayor, you brought up the economic side, the control
right,
aspect.
Right, okay? Right.
I don't know what the officer gets paid, but South Bend had a registration fee to pay for it.
Okay? Right.
So that is something that, from an economical standpoint, it alleviates any risk of the city having to pick up any extra funding to pay for control aspect.
Well, that's a good point, Sean. And then, but what? How much do you have to get to pay for all the services? I mean, somebody's going to collect that fee. That would probably be Casey Coles, right?
I don't do grass. I don't do leaves. And I'm telling you, I don't do chickens.
My point being, there has to be, somebody in place.
I really think that this is just something, and I really appreciate what you brought in. That is very eye-opening. But I think it's still something that we're going to have to discuss this. This is something that's going to happen at this meeting. And then this is very, very nice. I like it, and I like some of the information that, sizes. I have friends that don't live in the city, that live outside, that sometimes I babysit their chickens in the summertime when they're on vacation. Hey, it's kind of fun. But I think it's this thing that we'll have to discuss. And we aren't saying it's dead in the water. We're saying it's going to be a lot of talking and a lot of public opinion.
There's a lot of public opinion.
Our constituents are going to be the ones that dictate, when they call and ring your bell and say, hey, yay or nay. Yeah. That's the way I look at things, too.
And Ted, if I may, Lisa did mention, I did put out an email, which some of you seen because you've signed up for. And the responses you did not see were the ones that sent back to me privately or called me and said, hey, here's what we went through, things we did. And it was both pros and cons. And I got a lot of feedback on the positive side of it, a lot of communities that did. Sometimes it seemed like the majority that went with it were larger, but there were some that were even much smaller than us that allowed it. So that information, that if you guys are not signed up on the Municipal Works email listserv, there's probably about 30 of them. And I will group those together, and I can do one of two things. I can either forward those emails on as a group, and hopefully you can open them, or I can print them all off. So you guys just tell me after the meeting if you want that information and how you want it, and then I will forward that on. So it just gives you more information to review as well.
Hey, Shelby, can I ask a question? Can you look at demographics related to that? Because just listening to what Mason said, it's interesting that...
I requested population size.
Because I feel like for... Just thinking about, obviously, we have two different groups of people here. We're attempting to attract some young professionals. I don't like chickens. That doesn't mean that I am opposed to it. It's just that putting some specific ordinances in place that maybe attract a specific demographic of people that we are trying to build is not a bad thing. Obviously, John is correct in that there are so many details that need to be worked out. Ted is correct. Mayor Denton's also correct that you have to look at that. But for the sheer fact that we are attempting to draw some folks here, bigger cities often are populated by those young professionals. They're drawn to those places because they have freedoms that we in small towns do not always offer because we have no staff, right? That's a lot of it is the staff thing. Staffing is an issue. So it'd be interesting to demographically see if that's who
most
tends
all
to
them.
Have the chickens because you've got to weigh that part.
You're absolutely right. And yeah, I mean, the millennials.
To make the decision, because we want to draw those folks back, that's what I do every
you're
day.
Absolutely
I entertain
right.
millennials to keep them
right.
here and
you're
to draw them
right.
back because we don't need brain drain.
No, that's a good point.
And that's why Broad Ripple approved it, because, you know, you have the Carmel, the Noblesville, kind of the people who have made it, they can afford to live in those areas. Then you have the Broad Ripple area that's more of the, it's 25 to 35, and that was a huge draw for people at that point.
Because looking at what small wins can we allow people to have to be able to draw those folks, not producing undue stress on staff that are already stressed out, but is there some sort of
I got a feeling, though, if you open it up to a public meeting and said, come one, come all, we're going to be discussing this, it's like the people I heard from. I heard from four people. I heard from two who said, absolutely, I love to do it. I eat organic, and I eat well, and I would love to be able to do that. And then I heard from two realtors. Mm-hmm. He said, not on your worst day, do that. It's hard enough to sell a $500,000 home at Lake mm-hmm. Manitow mm-hmm. without the possibilities of somebody having chickens next door. You know, so there's the two schools of thought.
Yeah, and I think just doing the adequate research and making sure, you know, she at least has done a really good job of creating a...
Yeah, those properties are pretty small.
Oh, yeah. Well, we just have to bring this up to, you know, discuss it and get more information.
One more question for you. Well, that's okay. First of all, I do like the information. I think you did a really good job.
You did a lot of research.
Thank you.
You did. Thank
you. Mentioned containment of your chickens. Could you tell me what that is? This a chicken coop, and they stay in that, or is it a fenced area?
It's a coop, like a lower area and an upper area for the nesting boxes and the perches, and then down below there's an area where they eat, and then we have put in some stakes with some fencing, so they actually have an outdoor run area attached to that.
Okay.
So they can get out in. Another dumb fact is hens take dirt baths, so they like to bury themselves down in the dirt so they can go outside and do that, and they eat weeds, and so.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mayor Dunn, would you mind if I explain what the zoning code really is? So
oh,
when
no,
you guys are doing
do.
Your research, you understand kind of the both schools?
Sure.
The zoning code, actually, it goes for the whole county as far
you
as
you want to identify yourself.
All right, I'm Casey Coles. I'm the executive director of the Planning Commission.
Thank you.
The zoning ordinance is in effect for the entire county, so it's not only the city, but it's Kiwanis, Akron, so and the unincorporated and the town of Fulton. So I've dealt with it, chickens, animals, and the numbers in all different areas. Kiwanis, the code itself right now says that basically there's two residential districts that allow animals, farm animals. One is the river residential district. The other is a suburban residential district. Both require you to have at least an acre and a half of land to have any farm animals whatsoever. And there's a definition in the zoning code that defines what that includes. So obviously dogs and cats are not in that, but the rabbits, the chickens, we have everything from ferrets to alligators to raccoons.
Pigs?
Lots of pigs, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, outside the norm. I mean, we have people who have the exotics, and we have people who have the norm. One of the main reasons why they require the acre and a half, we actually took the numbers from Purdue, and we have all of the normal farm animals listed, and they are given a unit number. You're allowed 2 units per acre. And the units are actually based on the amount of nitrogen in the feces, and so that way you do not encounter the nitrogen overloading. Chickens, by ratio of weight, have the highest amount of nitrogen than the animal. Everybody, I do appreciate the presentation. Nitrogen is a good fertilizer. It's also very caustic if you don't know what you're doing. If you just take a load of chicken manure out and you put it on a brand new tree, it'll kill it like that. Actually, most chicken manure is more effective when it's a dry compost, not taken from the chicken coop. That's a misnomer. Most people don't realize that. The one thing that you really have to be careful of with chickens is the nitrogen overloading in your waterways. And I'm speaking from experience in the county, we have to really be careful with the chicken farms around the ditches and the river.
because nitrogen actually leads to algae blooms if you have too much of it. This isn't really about one family. Obviously, six chickens is not going to do that. Lake Manitow, I'm not trying to create everybody freak out with Lake Manitow. That's not it. But like you said, an ordinance is overreaching. It allows everybody in the city to have it. You can't say only the good people who will take good care of an animal can have it. You are going to say that everyone could have it if they meet these stipulations. And I know Kyle has only been on the job for a little while, but I'm sure he can attest to the same things that I've seen. Not everyone is as responsible as the Campbells. I've actually walked into a lot of houses with DCS to have the chickens living in the houses. And you're walking through the feces because it's never been cleaned, and so are the kids, and they're barefoot. And, you know, there are some very responsible families. There are some who are not. And you cannot put in an ordinance and discriminate intelligence versus non-intelligent. You know, do not have a chicken around your house if your kids are walking around barefoot, dropping its droppings. It's just not wise. There's a lot of things that you can get from animals from that. So I will throw that out there just to be cautious, because the enforcement of this, I joke with Mayor Denton, and I meant no disrespect, but I joked about the fact that I don't corral chickens. The enforcement of this goes
That was way, obvious.
It goes way beyond what your thoughts are, because if you have a registration process for who's going to have chickens, cost of that registration, it may help over, you know, it may help with a salary. It is by no means going to help with paying that salary. The fees I generate do not help with my salary. I know that the county pays it, and I'm sure the county council would tell you that. It doesn't even come close to paying for what I do. You have to choose between having a fee that is so exorbitant to help pay for that person's time and energy, and having a fee that is reasonable that allows people to have, you know, the millennial type of organic living that they want to have. And it's difficult. It's difficult for the councils. But your enforcement is going to have to deal with some kind of registration. I hope a fee to help alleviate the enforcement. The enforcement will have to be on a yearly basis, because I guarantee you those chicken coops are mobile. And so if you say 20 feet from a line, sure, when the inspector goes out there, it'll be 20 feet from the line. But you don't mow around something sitting in the middle of your yard when you have a 50-foot lot. You know, you take it, you push it back in the corner.
And they don't like that.
And the storm sewer may be sitting right outside the privacy fence in that back corner. So every time it rains, everything washes right down into your storm sewer. And all of these types of things, you're going to have somebody going around on an often basis, you know, and looking at this and making sure that whatever rules you put in place are going to be met. Because you do have your storm sewers to worry about, and you have the neighbors, and, you know, it could be sitting right next to a fence and the manure will go into the neighbor's yard. Maybe they have small kids and maybe they run around barefoot like my son. You know, these are things that it sounds great to have chickens. I have chickens. I have farm animals. I'm not against it. You know, we raise our own meat. We butcher. Not the house. I have somebody else do it. So I'm not as worried about people butchering the chickens, because that's an awful job. Nobody in the right mind would do that. My opinion. I've done it before. It's awful. But I think having the chickens there and being tired of them, when they start molting, they're very ugly. And you have to wait for them to grow their feathers back, so they're not so cute. When they're not chicks anymore, they're not so cute. Kiwana, actually, they changed their code because they have a lot of lots on the outside of the town limits that are 3/4 acre or larger. And so, and they had a lot of people who wanted to have chickens and this type of thing, and they did not want them in the, in the inner town, in the heart of the city, the heart of the town. But the people who have the larger lots on the outskirts, the 3/4 acre, they didn't mind, because it's a larger acreage that can absorb that nitrogen and take care of itself. They put a number limit on it. They said that they had to have 3/4 acre, and anybody who did not have 3/4 acre had to get a special exception for it. And I believe they also put in their new roosters. It's very difficult to differentiate between the breeds of a hen versus a meat chicken, unless you were going to go through every single breed of a hen that is not used for meat chickens. You know, your meat chickens are pretty stable. You get them at Wilson's, no big deal. I have 4 different breeds of chickens out in my chicken coop right now. You know, some are prettier than others. I like to have different colors this year, because next year I'll get a different color. I know which ones to butcher in 3 years. You know, that's my system. But, I mean, if you go through the breeds, you'd have to put every single one of them in there and say, these are the only breeds you can have. Yeah, it's kind of like telling, It's just the enforcement of it. I wanted to put this food for thought in there so when you're thinking of it, not only with your code, but when you shift your code, then you would want to request for the zoning ordinance to be amended for the city as well, which is fine. We can do that with the Plan Commission. They give a recommendation to you, and then you would approve that. So that's not as big of a deal. Unfortunately, and I know I've spoken to many people in the past and currently, you know, chickens are not legal inside the city limit. So when we do notice somebody has chickens, we send out a violation letter. And it's one of those things that they pop right back up. You know, if they're behind a privacy fence, it's difficult. So we have to go back out and see if they're still there and send another one.
Just if you may not know this off the top of your head, that point system you're talking about, mm-hmm. you said chickens are the highest by weight. Do you know what their number is safe per acre?
Our unit? Or
yeah.
Oh, I have no clue.
Okay.
I'm sorry, yeah.
No problem.
It's a lot more than you would think. A lot more than you would think. You can have over 20,000 chickens on 10 acres. I mean, that's the going confined feeding operation for a chicken that stays under IDEMS numbers. Is those are the ones we're getting out in the county right now. It's over 20,000 chickens. That's confined though. That's mm-hmm. on one barn. They never get to see daylight. They're raised to weight and they're shipped out. Or they stay there and they lay until they stop laying and then they're taken away and they're put in the dog.
This is a city boy question, okay? And maybe you or Campbell's could answer this, but on these ordinances where they were allowing chickens and with some stipulations, they all said no roosters. What's wrong with the rooster?
Loud. Those are the ones that you hear.
Okay.
And where there's a rooster, there's fertilized eggs, and when you have hens, they like to lay on their eggs, and so then you end up with more chickens. And
I think it has more to do with their temperament, the noise and the temperament. Roosters can be very mean, and they get spurs on the back of their legs that curl under, and they'll attack you when they have hens around because they get protective. And so they'll jump on your shoulders and they'll spur you and peck you.
I'm just picturing it.
You're like,
not on you.
Casey, when someone corrals chickens, not you.
Right, not me.
Where do they, if they do corral a chicken, where do they take it?
I have no clue.
Does the animal shelter take chickens?
No. Animal shelter restricts you dogs and cats.
I bet we could find a few farmers around who would take any.
Well, I get, but that's the point going to the mayor's thing. But
you would have to have an arrangement. Well, and I will tell you this, going back to that though, depending on the farmer, like me personally, I would tell you no. Mm-hmm. I do not want anything that I didn't raise on my land. And the reason why is because they bring in other diseases. Mm-hmm. That's why a lot of the farms, when you'll have like the bird flu and that type of thing going around, they don't allow visitors. They don't want you on there. And even the inspectors, when they go on, all of the poultry houses have showers. So when they come in, you know,
really,
it's, you know, like a Class C hazmat uniform. I mean, they put it on and they walk in, they got the booties. I mean, it's the whole suit. So.
Excuse me, Casey, you're looking at larger houses and you're looking at biosecurity when we start discussing stuff like that. So when you're looking at a lot of the avian flu and the chicken diseases and things like that, that would be, you would have to keep Wilson's or Big R from bringing them actually into the community and anybody infesting any of those areas, walking in, walking out, or any traffic. So when you're looking at the ordinance and how it's currently written, they're looking at just more of a small scale, not a large scale, such as that. And that's what Elisa had stated is, that's what's up to, you know, when you start putting together the restrictions of what's out there, that's where the council has got all the ability to say so many square feet, so many hens, you know, and that's the discussion point. But you're taking it to the nth degree when you're looking at 20,000 per acre, you know.
No, they asked a question, I answered, and actually you're incorrect. Most farmers who have any livestock, you know, I only have 12 chickens. I do not want your chicken with my chickens.
Oh, I agree.
Because they can carry a sickness and then you can kill all my chickens. And what I'm saying is if you have to have a place to put them for the people who are not registered, mm-hmm. and when whomever confiscates them, they have to take them somewhere. Right. And it may be difficult to find a place to take them unless it's a designated this cage only for confiscation and it's way over here and you know nothing can be transmitted. I was just saying that it goes from small to large. I mean, even the large operators, the inspectors, you know, they're very, very careful with that.
All righty. Well, hey, thank you for educating this city boy. Yes, ma'am.
Sort of brought something up to my mind is how many people think when they get an animal from the animal shelter, and we have a delightful animal shelter, and we have worked hard at getting a very good animal shelter.
Excuse me, Ron.
I don't bring an animal into my household unless it sees a vet
right.
beforehand.
Excuse me just for interrupting you, but could you identify yourself for the record?
I'm Sandra Campbell.
Okay. Thank you. Kyle, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, you wanted a quick update?
Yeah, I'd like to know what you've been about. Sure. Yeah, we don't see you very often.
All over the place.
How are the cats and the dogs working out? And by the way, how's the job going for you?
I'm really enjoying it. Good. For those who don't know, I'm Kyle Bergen, the Elk Boss for Fulton County. You're asking about numbers and you know, business wise. I do have a August monthly report. I do a monthly report to the county commissioners. It goes to the sheriff and them. And I do break it down between county and city on number of calls, number of visits to those calls, and then dogs, cats taken to the shelter. So, for instance, for a total month in August, I had 96 total calls. Only 34 of those came out of town, and those calls were only required 34 visits. I had 14 dogs, they all came from the county. I had 26 cats, and 10 of those came from the city in August. I went through and did some numbers today, because my September reports aren't done because the month's not over. So far this month, I've had 24 calls in town, 26 visits to those calls, 2 dogs, 5 cats, and like we said before, 1 bird, it was not a chicken. It was a homing pigeon that I dealt with Saturday night, 8 o'clock at night. So. Yes.
A homing pigeon?
Yes, we had a pet pigeon that needed a home because the owner was incarcerated.
So not like a.
Okay, yeah,
not like a.
No, it is that type of pigeon.
Okay,
it is. Oh. In this gentleman's motel room with
okay. a homing pigeon that needed a home.
So I was requested by officers to come out, and I'll be honest with you. I don't want to jump ahead. I do have some thoughts on the chicken idea, but I did have an issue trying to find a place for that chicken or for that homing pigeon, because we are not equipped for that in our county right now. The animal shelter, I'll touch on them real quick before I get to the chicken stuff. I know last time I was here, I talked about the spay and neuter program, which our grant started in August. We did one day in August, one day in September. It's proven to be very successful. Like I said, one day only, so 2 months, so 2 days total. I got some numbers from them today. Within those 2 days, out of those 2 months, we've had 20 dogs participate, 40 owned cats or pet cats, and 150 community cats, which is a stray cat, feral cat, or a barn cat. So 150 cats out of our county. That is countywide, not just city. You know, the differentiation of the numbers there.
Are those catch and release after they're?
This program is not through me. The ones I bring in go up to the shelter like for adoption, or they go up for free as barn cats or warehouse cats. Another thing they do. The spay-neuter program is purely from people, just individuals doing it on their own. So some may release, some may be their barn cats. They're getting done just very responsible for the population. But like 150 community cats within 2 days and 2 months. So October, I just put flyers out today if anybody's interested. You have some right here at the town hall, the bulletin board. I give a copy to Sean every month. I mean, give them some post office and stuff. More exposure we can get, the better. Because of the popularity, we have expanded to 2 days in October. It's just a private company. I do have a little flyer here. Like I said, they're posted. I don't know if you're putting that on Facebook. I know we
talked. The city doesn't have a Facebook page.
The shelter. Yeah, any questions at all? So the shelter can help you out with that.
Do you have an electronic version of that?
No, it's all through the shelter. Janet, maybe I'll email to you, Janet Shanley out there.
I can get that on Facebook.
Because I get this is what I get. This is what
and
I get.
I'll scan an email to you.
So. Yeah, I got to drop off your office today. Just for information, if people are interested in this, October is most likely the last event this year. I resume in the spring. They're going to look for more grant money with that. Other things the shelter is doing, all the excellent work they're doing, I have been keeping them busy. They've expanded their microchipping. Are people familiar with microchipping? It's just a simple microchip outside of a grain of rice. And it's implanted underneath the skin, simple injection. They are now scheduling and performing those at the animal shelter. It's a $20 fee for dogs or cats. All you do is go schedule it with them. They implant the chip, and then you have to call or register online with the company. And I am now carrying a microchip scanner along with the animal shelter. I was donated one by the Indianapolis Animal Control. So it helps get pets home and keep running our shelter. So $20 is an excellent investment. I highly recommend it to anybody who's interested. Janet asked me to put this out here. Chili Cook-Off is October 8th. The animal shelter is having Nelson's Pork Pit chicken. They do have pre-sale tickets on sale for $7. If anybody enters in that, contact the shelter.
Did you make him do that commercial?
I think I vicariously.
I have typed out.
We got a straight line.
I actually typed out. She talked to Janet today about numbers, and she helped me out and helped her out. So we're working together really well out there.
Good. Well, listen, I want to thank you for your efforts. I'm glad you're doing so well. Appreciate the attack on the cats. We appreciate that.
Yeah, we're doing good with that. But.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Appreciate it. Okay, moving right on into department reports. Let's start with Fire Chief Butler.
Good evening. We're going to receive a copy of our report in your minutes. For August, auto fire alarms, 4 in the city, mutual aid fires, 3 in Henry Township, 2 Liberty Township, 1 Abenaki Township, and an oven fire in the city, vehicle fires, 1 in the city, 1 in Newcastle Township, calls for smokes, 1 in the city, accidents, 3 in the city, 2 in Rochester Township, 2 in Richmond Township. Medical assist, we had 18 in the city, 19 in Rochester Township, 1 in Richland Township, 1 in Newcastle Township. We drove the ambulance twice, and we responded to a missing child in the city. Had a total of 51 calls and 1 drill. If you have any questions, that concludes my report.
Like that. Concise.
Be quick, get real, be long.
Thank you, Chief. Good job. Wonderful. All righty.
Thank you, Chief.
That was a little bit of pressure on two shots, I would say.
Okay.
Don't shake hands with him, Tom.
He knows better.
Andy, that's a hard act to follow, but you're up, Chief like Shots.
I'll try, I promise.
Sweet, come on.
And go get some Calamine loot.
Month of August, we had 21 accidents, 84 total warnings, 44 offenses, 38 total case reports, 748 incidents, 41 lockouts, 3 towed vehicles, 10 people incarcerated. And you have the list of crimes that they were incarcerated for. Also, Sunday, this Sunday is an A-Bait ride. We're going to block off the 100 block of East 8th, just so you guys know or aware of it. And then we have to fully grip off the 8th. That's all I have, unless you have any questions. Wow. Yeah, I've ruined it, don't you?
You blocked off, I assume, cars need to move.
Yes, we're blocking that off early Sunday morning.
Andy, is that 3 a.m.? That's what I've been propagating. Is that correct?
Ish.
Okay. I've been telling people
3
a.m.
Ish.
Because I got a call.
Whenever the guys get a chance, Saturday night, between Saturday night and Sunday morning, we're going to block off for the ride. Is that what we're talking about? For the car show?
The car.
Probably about the same time.
Okay.
And I let the fire chief slip away before asking or letting him comment on this, but both of you are going to have a vehicle in the car show, right?
Yes.
Yes. They win.
So that's an easy one. Easy choice. Yeah.
Any other questions for Chief Shots?
We'll quiz you how much you know about cars.
Yeah. Right. Thank you.
Thank you, Andy.
Okay, Warren is ill, so let's move right on to Derek. The Water Department.
Feeling okay? You're going in order this time.
I know. Sometimes, you know, you feel like a nut. Sometimes you don't.
You guys all got a copy of my report?
Yep.
You have any questions?
The only thing is, you gave Garrett's report better than he did when you read the list. So we'll have to put up with Garrett.
He's been threatened.
He's got a taser. Okay, for the month of August, I won't go through the first six, seven things there. I'll just start where the first seven are basic, what we normally do. Ran the weed eater and sprayed weeds around some hydrants. Myself and Randy went and attended a meeting in Peru on the 3rd. Changed a 3-inch meter at the Quality Inn Hotel. Cleaned the upper garage, cleaned the meter room. Went through the bad meters to get them sent out for repairs. Touched up a hydrant at Goose Pond Road. We had a gentleman that painted the hydrant after we painted it, so we had a discussion and prepared the situation.
Tell him what he painted it.
Smiley face.
It was a good thought.
It was an older gentleman, and he apologized.
Did not realize they were a certain color for a reason.
Right.
Yeah.
Changed a 3-inch meter at Woodlawn Hospital. And then the painting of the hydrants, those guys finished up in August, and then painted 30 hydrants the first week of August, and then they were complete. Total hydrants painted for the summer of 2016 was 450. Total hydrants not painted for the summer of 2016 was 35. Those are because they've been replaced or they were obviously brand new ones for a project.
Okay, so we had no hydrants that didn't get attention. That
right.
Needed. Yeah.
Maybe okay. They're already been taken care of before they're
changed out.
That was leaving us with a total number of 485 hydrants. Other digs that were performed, we converted the curb stop at the Elks Maintenance Garage to an outside pit and ran a new water line over to a yard hydrant. And then we went back a few days later because the tree service decided to run it over and crush it. So we fixed that. We replaced the yard hydrant at the City Park Maintenance Garage, repaired a leaking valve at 1316 Jackson Boulevard, replaced the fire hydrant at 12th and Pontiac that was leaking, and then call outs. Myself was called out on the 2nd at 3:45 p.m. for a burglar alarm at the plant. Everything checked out okay. I was called out again on the 3rd at 4:37 p.m. to 2408 Bayview Drive for a leak under the trailer. The water was shut off at the curb for repairs. Randy Carr was called out on the 9th at 5:56 a.m. to 907 Ford Drive for a leak inside the house. And then I was also called in for the same thing at 6:26 because he asked for my assistance to take the air compressor out there. The water got shut off and the repairs were made. Randy Wynn was called out on the 17th at 4:03 p.m. to 1228 Monroe Street due to a mix-up with shutting the upper apartment off. This apartment was on one shut-off, so it needed to turn back on. I was called out on the 26th at 3:35 p.m. to 2509 Barrett Road due to an emergency locate for a gas leak at the residence. That's all I have. Do you have any questions?
Do you have any questions for Derek?
No, I think he does a wonderful job, personally.
Oh, he does a great job. Thank you,
thanks,
sir.
Thanks, Derek.
Lenny, you're up. Street department.
Well, we changed trash can receptacles downtown. Chip brush, picked up brush, ran the recycling route. That's what 2 to 3 days of our week starts out doing. Worked on some, changing out some signs, some faded ones, some missing ones. Raised manhole on Monticello Road as it got blacktopped and was like 2 inches below the grade. We graded and stoned an alley on Rochester Boulevard. Worked on trimming up some alleys. Took apart both of the white self-contained leaf boxes. The one just needed a collar and a new impeller. and the other one needed a whole Bell housing unit. But the impeller on that one was good. We made some new stairs for the stage as the old ones were rotted and getting a break. We cleaned up the shop. We painted some parking lines on West 7th Street by Fulton County Medical Clinic and Bradley's Heating and Cooling. And we patched some potholes with blacktop.
Okay. Might want to mention our efforts with Duke. I'll just kind of fill it in there. When I came into office, we had almost 40 lights throughout the city that needed attention. Owned by Duke, you know, we're paying a maintenance fee to Duke and a, you know, obviously the electric bill. Some of those went back into the past administration. Their maintenance of our lights was very, very, very slow. Lenny and Warren, I've been in contact with them very regularly, and as of today, I believe we're all up to snuff throughout the city. They had contracted the service for those lights out to a private contractor, which just was not working very well. And now the service is being done by the local lineman again, which is how it was done years ago. I had a light complaint today over on 12th Street. Joe Knotts had it taken care of before the end of the day. So that's wonderful news. And if you guys drive through town, you'll say, hey, it's kind of bright around here.
Lights on the city.
Yeah, well, Lenny's been all over that.
You get some company down from Cope or Indianapolis in that area, and they get Elizabeth Street. Now they have no clue. So there they are, busy trying to find Elizabeth Street. And you get the hometown guy here that knows town, and it speeds up the process.
Right, could get right to it. Yeah.
But in a little bit of the park note, I'd like to thank the Olive Branch Church from Roanne area. They're out there painting the Ed McMahon, or Ed,
Not Ed McMahon. Ed Fansler.
Sorry about that. Ed Fansler. Gazebo out there at the airport, and does the donation work, and they've done other donation work for the park at the entrance. As you walk into Manasol Mountain, they donated all that landscaping and stuff and put that in, and they've helped us out quite a bit. I just like to do that.
And it should be noted, too, that with the chili cook-off coming, we'll be scouring downtown with a fine-tooth comb. And Lenny and his crew have been keeping it very nice, as it has been. But we'll be scouring it big time before Saturday. And the other thing with that, there'll be more trash containers out, and we'll have a crew working all day on the trash situation.
I know we had spoken about that today. I hadn't had a chance. I think Greta had spoken.
Greta gave me a call.
Because we have, we're utilizing the probation department from, I believe, 8 a.m. until 2 p.m. Unfortunately, we attempted to try to find some volunteers. We were even willing to pay volunteers to be able to cover the trash from 2 to 4. We have been unable to do that just because it's fall break for the kiddos. So we even tried to rent a couple wrestlers, but we were unable to do that. So we had an events committee today, and Diana and Pee Wee Smith were there. And it has been noted that between 2 and 4 is the really difficult time because the chili, I guess the award ceremony is at 2. And so from 2 to 4, they're breaking down. The trash just overrun. So we've been trying to figure out how.
We'll take care of it, don't worry.
Okay.
We'll be there in force.
Perfect. Yeah, and I spoke to Mike Gibbons because I know that he's in charge of the actual sidewalks related to the county. So I've been speaking to him on your behalf because I know last year that we were attempting to figure out who was in charge of that area. So he's been keeping the leads down around the courthouse. Hopefully, I think he's on vacation at the moment, but he'll be back. And
we'll probably steal a couple of the park department's trash cans.
Borrow, Lenny. Okay. We'll borrow them.
Borrow
them. And Mike's trash is Mike's.
Well, I always return what I steal.
Mike's trash is being very gracious to us, and they're donating an additional dumpster and 20 toters. So Mike's trash is doing that as a donation.
Those will be located.
The two dumpsters will be on 8th Street on both sides, so one on the RTC side and one on the other side, from what I understand. and then the toters will be throughout the city, the downtown, wherever we feel like
we can take advantage of some of that.
So we'll be there. I'll be there at 6 a.m. on Saturday with Brian Lewis sending out picnic tables, starting the process. So we'll just work with everybody.
Okay, great. Anything else for Lenny?
Let's go back to the lights. If there are lights out, who should you contact?
Lenny at the street department, the mayor, any of us. Give us a holler.
You can call in yourself, but I'm willing to help.
But usually, the only thing is, they're noticed at night, and you guys aren't working at night.
Actually, we send Mr. Warren out periodically. He calls it a date night for he and his wife. He's a cheat. They go around looking for lights that are out and then record it. But if you see one and you want to report it, Brian, the poles all have a number on them. Just write the number down and give us the number.
Okay. And a lot of times, me and Warren will come in early in the morning and check things out, too. So.
That's, thank you, Lenny.
Thanks, Lenny.
Thank you.
Dear. Yeah, he says his wife won't let him go out alone like that. Okay, reports of our committees. The Area Plan Commission. You had a long one.
Yes, we did. 10:30. Yes, the Area Plan Commission met last evening, and there were a few of the articles in the zoning ordinances that were changed, updated, spiffed up, whatever you want to call it, and that was in Article 4, Article 5, and Article 11. Most of them were basically simplifying some of the wording in the amendment itself, and there were a few changes on lines that they came to met what the state was meaning as far as like signage and boundary lines on signage on the highways and things. That's about it.
Okay. Any questions for Karen?
So boundary lines on signage, like wayfinding signage, or are you speaking about signage?
Large signs.
Like billboard.
Mm-hmm. Billboard.
FETCO. Okay, Mr. Goodman's absent. Park Board, Mason.
I was unable to attend.
Okay. Lenny, you got a couple of things to report on the park board, yeah?
Basically, just going over some of the things that we've ordered and
gonna get the water hydrant up.
Yeah, we got working on a sidewalk
at the park,
the big gazebo. It's that new pad that we just EMB just asphalted and try to get the drinking fountain up and going before. You know, the winter hits and stuff, but that's basically that.
Got a couple of trees being worked on in the park.
Yeah.
And
dead trees and marking them out for next year's budget to get trimmed up.
And the basketball goals that you had put up at the
JC
Park.
Yeah, they're all up and going. Basically, it's been mowing and trying to keep track of this mowing. The grass has been growing phenomenally this year, and that's about it, really.
And there's going to be an effort to take care of the drainage problem at Manitow Mountain.
Yeah, up there in the entrance to the mountain, we're going to get that issue addressed. And we've had the new... I don't know if you noticed, but every one of our parks has got a sign up there says, oh, welcome to Manitow Mountain. It's on two poles. And they we've been working on getting them repainted, and Denny Conley had been painting them. And so if you get a chance to take a look, because there's nothing been done to them for like 12 years.
They look really nice.
They look like new ones. They look really good.
They look really nice.
And.
Okay. The Redevelopment Commission, Terry's not here this evening. He's been out of town. I did notice in the minutes from the last council meeting that I had two appointments to make. I'd actually made those appointments in August to the Redevelopment Commission. My
appointments were based on choosing someone who had vested interest in the downtown program. In other words, building owners. So I chose Ruth Gunter and Dan Betcher. Of course, Ruth owns the restaurant, the Evergreen, and Dan bought the B&B store. So they're now on the commission.
I can give a little bit of an update for that.
Okay, sure.
If you will. The Redevelopment Commission, Rochester Redevelopment, and the Rochester Downtown Partnership met this past week in a combined effort to talk about a plan for 2017, looking at the funding. So obviously Terry's been working.
You did not introduce yourself, ma'am.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. Amy Rowe, Fulton County Chamber of Commerce. Thank you, shut up. To be official. And so we had on the recommendation of Mark Smith and some other folks to come up with a common vision as to what direction everybody's moving so that there is not a lack of direction and or too many efforts. We had brought the two teams together, obviously the Redevelopment Commission having done the plan and the Rochester Downtown Partnership as the volunteer effort to move that plan forward. We came together to decide who, what, when, and where. And so some projects have been chosen based on what the Redevelopment Commission has decided to put their money towards, but also the Rochester Downtown Partnership to put their money towards. And in attendance also was the theater group to sit and understand what the downtown plan was. Emily Gottschalk looked at that and understanding it so that they could understand where they fit within that hierarchy and the organizational chart. So providing some direction, some confirmation of party lines, if you will, so that all the folks can get in line and move towards a common goal. And so for the Rochester Downtown Partnership, looking at MSRP to do some cosmetic upgrades downtown, potentially some wayfinding signage, which is why I was asking about signage, through some OCRA grants. And then the Rochester Redevelopment looking at the 9th and Main, the DNR, and one other main project, which I believe was, the facade grant. So they're going to give an additional $25,000 to the Rochester Downtown Partnership for the facade grant program. So those were the main three for the Redevelopment Commission as far as what they had decided with our joint meeting.
Amy, I have people asking all the time about the theater group. Is there anything they're working on that you could report?
Yeah, so they, I think it was very helpful for them. They are a group that's very passionate. The capacity or skills of understanding grants and procedures and public proceedings, that's probably lacking, but that's not a bad thing. They came and they have a lot of passion. So they are working very diligently towards their 501c3. Barry Baldwin is helping them. He helps the Rochester Downtown Partnership to do theirs. So they have done a lot of work on the actual theater, a lot of volunteers who are just making it so that they can have a clean palette to work with. There was a gentleman that I had met at an OCRA conference that Sarah and I went to named Paul Vincent, and he is out of Fort Wayne, and he understands grants related to historic structures, especially grants to redevelop those, and so I put those two in connection, so they've been working with him. In addition, they have somebody who lives in New York currently who's from Rochester. Unfortunately, I cannot remember her name. I just know that she has very colorful hair, like these ladies. which I don't feel
right now.
Go to get a close up.
That's not something I do. So I have brown hair.
I'm going to go put my pink streak back in now.
But she was here for 1 week during the summer to be able to help them to understand. She has a lot of connections in the New York market of understanding theater. So she was coming, providing some guidance on what it looks like as far as what they should move forward with. So they've got a lot of traction, they've got a lot of passion, they're doing a lot of good
work. But there's some, did I hear you right, there's some sweat equity going on right now.
They're cleaning
out.
The wall between the two theaters is gone.
Oh, really? Oh, yes. Wow. Okay.
So they've been doing some demo while they've been working on.
I noticed today someone was sweeping out in front, and it looked like glass had fallen off the marquee. Mm-hmm. Is that something that needs to be looked into as far as for concerns, safety concerns for the city, because I saw a lady out there sweeping it up, and the junk started, the glass is starting to fall.
Yeah, I know that Brian Goodman and his team, Modern Materials, they are actually offering to redo that through the process that they have powder coating or whatever it is, the process, obviously. They have been in contact with each other to basically take the marquee out and redo that. So I don't know where they are in the process with that.
Well, I'm not worried about any of that. Only thing I'm concerned about is glass falling down and safety on people.
Yeah, and I could put you in contact with the lead on that team if you'd like to speak to him about that.
Well, I would put one of the chiefs in charge of it because they're in charge of protecting our city. And if it needs to have one, if it needs to have the city go down and, you know, block it off or something and put something, if it's something that could reoccur.
Or if the owner, even John, if it can be taken down without too much disruption and destruction and put someplace until.
I do know that as far as the marquee is concerned, the whole structure itself, there are beams that run
all the way to the back of the building.
So the marquee itself is not going anywhere, but so it would just be
the pieces of it could.
That are where they would put the names of the movies kind of thing.
The only thing I'm interested in is the glass.
Right.
Yeah, you just let us know. We can connect whoever needs to be connected to talk to them and make that happen.
If you need barrels, if they need barrels, get a hold of Lenny.
Okay.
We'll get into that.
Yeah, but they are working very diligently. They haven't lost steam. They were very appreciative to be able to sit with the team of the redevelopment. As far as when they're seeking funding through the grants that Paul Vincent will be offering, from what I understand, they don't anticipate, because the Rochester Downtown Partnership had their 501c3 within 3 days, which is unheard of, but they don't anticipate that it's going to be the same for them. So they're looking at potentially 2018 being when they would start looking at the granting process.
Okay. All right. Yeah, thank you. Appreciate that. Any other questions, gentlemen? Okay, the BZA, Marty.
Well, first of all, I didn't know Lenny was available to make our committee report, so. Do you have anything you want to add for the BZA, Lenny? No, okay.
Thomas is fine.
Just checked.
He's a man for all seasons.
I know. I did not realize that till tonight, so now I'm glad to know.
I'm going to go for something after the Kimber offer.
Actually, before you start regarding Lenny, I want you all to tune in at 8:15 tomorrow morning on WRI, because Lenny will be accompanying me on the radio.
Yeah.
And you really didn't want me doing that.
He told me I had to wear a muzzle, though. I told Tom to be bashful to be
No. I'm sorry, Marty.
No, that's fine. Quickly report on last month's meeting, because that was the day after our council meeting. They did listen to three appeals for variance, and they granted all three of those. I believe that tomorrow is one of the busier nights, Casey's gone, that the BZA's ever had. They've got seven items in front of them tomorrow night. One is older business regarding a communication tower that Crown Castle owns. They've got a signage variance. There's a pavilion building and a privacy fence all in one. There's a new home at the lake. There's another porch in town, another new home at the lake, and a garage facility on a lot without a dwelling. So that's the BZA meeting for tomorrow night.
Any questions on the BZA? Sorry.
As for Council on Aging, we had a long meeting Monday as well. For the transpo portion of it, the new driver that was hired a couple of weeks ago has not worked out. So they are looking for another driver. And two of the current drivers have attained master driver status for 2016, so that was a good thing. For the Council on Aging, We're looking for another new board member. I think that was probably resolved before we got out of the meeting. And that is to replace Dan Ronk, who has moved to Logansport. And Dick Bonso has actually wants to stay on the board, but he's asked to resign as treasurer, which he has held the position for a long time. Some of you that know Dick, he and his wife have both struggled health-wise for a little while. So Randy Sutton is going to become the new treasurer of Council on Aging. As far as the director's report went, we were a little bit out of compliance on our random drug testing of the drivers. That's the only employees that are drug tested, and that has now been corrected, and we are in full compliance. Had a couple of the stools that went bad in the restrooms, and Warren went down, looked at those, and okayed the repair, the replacement of the two stools, plus some faucets that were leaking. I reported last month that the fire alarm system in the garage was not hooked up. Now it is hooked up, it is working, and as they did that, they realized that the strobes and the horns were not hooked up either. So another $700 is being required of the county to do that. The probation department provided six people to help clean up around the place, and they pressure washed. They borrowed the city's pressure washer, I understand, and used that to help clean up. They worked in the garage cleaning that up as well. Few other things that aren't worth mentioning here, but well, I mean, I've, in the spirit of the chief's reports,
so you can send those to me ahead of time. I can email them out with the package.
Well, yeah, maybe I will. We did. I mentioned last month as well that we learned that we're responsible for overseeing RSVP. And so we had the RSV department coordinator Ann King come and give her first report to our board. And then the drum roll on the numbers of trips. Units of trips, August 2016, 4,169 trips.
Wow.
That's
wow. Jeez.
600 trips from a year ago in that month. So, yes, it's incredible what's going on down there. So,
you haven't driven your car since when, Mark?
About 2 years. Streets are a lot safer. That is my report on Council on Aging. If there's any questions,
Questions for Marty?
If I may mention something about that I learned about transpo that I thought it was an interesting topic for me, but there are several families that put their children.
Thank you, Don.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I thought it was like a mirror here.
Hi, I'm Shada Beeler, the clerk treasurer for the city of Rochester. Thank you very much. But I had learned that they transport a lot of young children.
Yes.
That parents entrust transpo to and I'm talking young, like my age children.
Yes.
Back on their own.
Mm-hmm.
And the parents, there's a trust issue there with transpo that those children are going to be transported safely. And I just found that, fascinating. And I thought it was a great thing on our behalf that our community, we have that kind of relationship between transpo and our community members. And I just wanted to give them kudos for that, because I would have never given it a thought, myself personally as a parent, to put my child on a transpo van to go from point A to point B. But knowing we have several families that do that, and yeah, our transpo folks take good care of those little guys,
yeah,
and make sure that they're safe.
We have several families that do that.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't realize it was that to that extent either. I knew some kids were being taken to school and such.
Wow. So does that money go back into the money that, I know it's not a lot of money, but the money that's received from the transpo, does that go back into running transpo?
The fees.
So it's not towards anything specific, just the running of the department?
Yep.
Okay. Chase, Solid Waste and Animal Adoption Center.
There was a new solid waste meeting, and really Kyle summed up everything I was going to say. Thank you, Kyle. I mean, please come back every month.
is there any news on the building? Aren't they going?
Yeah, we're getting really close. Working with Kenny Anderson, getting that finalized with the state, and hopefully break ground before winter hits, hopefully. Yep.
Okay. Any questions for Chase? Okay, Tree Board and EMS, Brian.
All right. Tree Board met, the first meeting was on September 1st. At that meeting, the opening of the bids for the second round of tree removal, and the Ugly Truck Company was the company that was accepted for that. They are going to be start getting their trees removed. After that meeting, there was also Jim Mulligan was a guest at the meeting. He said that there was another tree between 15th and 16th Street on Main, I guess an old ash tree, that is at some point will fall down. And so that is added onto the list of the
trees to take.
Well, the constituents who had requested that trees be removed, or that Warren or Lenny had seen that they need to come down. However that was missed, I don't know, because if you drive past it, it needs to come down.
It's bad, isn't it?
So we're coordinating with NDOT to try to get stuff done, because nothing else, that road's got to be closed at least partially while that work comes down. So
I don't know if you've had any of the questions or any of the Tree Board members, but I have. The Townsend Tree Service that's in town cutting trees, they are an agent of Duke Energy there. We don't have anything to do with the Townsend Tree Service, and the tree cutting going on there is for power lines and such. I don't know if you'd had any of those questions approached.
No, I can pass that on as to when the next round of bids come out to continue, send it to them.
Oh, no, they're contracted specifically for Duke. They're not interested in.
Well, they may be.
I guarantee you, they're not interested in our situation. Yeah. They cut trees a little differently than our.
Across the country.
Don't you think? Yeah.
They had applied for a grant with the Community Foundation, and was given that grant, and it's going to help pay for the trees that will be going on Main Street. So that is in the process right now, and that leads into the next meeting, which was September 15th, and they talked about which trees would go where. Looked at the ordinance that we have, and you can or cannot have these trees, can't have flowering or fruiting crabs.
Fruiting crabs or any of the
hawthorns.
Thistle.
Thorny
type.
Hawthorns.
Thorny hawthorns. Yeah.
We don't have any. We don't have any.
Easy for you to say. Yeah.
But it did help that at the second meeting we had two or three tree specialists who said, yes, those, all the ones, either if they fruit, then they don't have thorns, but if they don't fruit, they do have thorns. So it may need to come before the council to amend the ordinance regarding those specific items in terms of whatever trees go in. But since then, they had, working within the ordinance that we do have, they marked, or they went all down Main Street, said which trees need to go where, in terms of the tree lawn size and the canopy size of the tree. You want to have a tree that fits the spot. So
hey, Ryan,
moving forward, 1 minute.
Oh,
we're moving forward on getting that next step of having the trees purchased, dug in, planted. The ones that they can't get it done now, then they have to do them in the spring. But they're saying because of the weather and dormancy and everything else, now is the better time to plant them rather than later on.
I believe redbud trees were also one of the trees that you could be used.
It could be. I'd have to look back
and
see.
But there's some challenges with redbuds.
Redbud also, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because of the way they...
Yeah.
Amy, you had a question?
Just a quick question. Amy Rowe, Coltine Chamber of Commerce. When you say Main Street, just so I don't get in trouble, Main Street, you don't mean Main Street, you mean like South Main Street, not actual...
Like between where and where?
Main Street between 9th and 18th.
9th and 18th South, okay.
Like 9th and 17th because...
Yeah, South
okay.
Main.
South Main Street, okay.
Okay, any other questions about the trees? EMS?
Have not met. They will meet next week. They meet quarterly now.
Okay. Water Board, John?
Water Board did meet. And, of course, I went over the delinquent list for September, reviewed, approved. As Derek had said earlier, that everything was operating normally. Chad asked the board for a problem that we ran into about duplex housing, apartment housing also, that we've run into a problem where we have, in a duplex, we have one meter. Upstairs doesn't pay their bill, so you shut off the house. Downstairs, they're paying, but they don't have any water either. So. What we are going to do is we are going to get a, Marvin made a motion with a second from Jim, and what they're going to do is get the landowner's name will be on the water bill. So he can devise any way he wants to go about getting the money for him to pay it. He can have his people pay it. But when it comes to a shutoff, they will be able to complain to the landlord that the bill has not been paid, and it will not come. It will not come to the water department. And it will save Derek a lot of headaches. Everybody a lot of headaches, or of course they can put two meters in at their expense if they'd like, but that it sounds just like a really good idea. They discussed some wages, and the wages for the employees were for the water department. Randy Carr is going to get a dollar raise, an additional $1.75 to equal a $2.75 raise, taking him to 17.25. Randy Wynn gets a dollar, taking him to $19.95, and Derek Holloway had his salary set at 52 for this coming year of 20 for their budget for 2017. Marvin made a motion, and it was seconded by Keith. Derek had presented quite a few things to the board to add to the budget for 17. Some of them will be for 17, some will be 18, some will be 19. I'm just going to let you know some of the things that are going to happen quickly, and that's going to be replace the old trailer with a new trailer. Marvin asked to get another quote, and that's what Derek said he would do and have it for the October meeting, and replacing the old blue Ford pickup truck. It'll be a shame to see it go away because it's got a long history with the city, period. And the board asked Derek to start getting some quotes on that. And then Derek made an idea that the guys that helped us past summer, painting all the hydrants, as you have heard, they did the work, general work for us. They did an excellent job, and I know everybody saw them out working every day. Good guys, they work 29 hours a week, and we're gonna raise their pay up for next year to $9.25 an hour, and hopefully get both of them to come back and work for the city next year. And of course, that was past 3-0. And in case there are any other questions, that's really wrapping up the replacement, I'm sorry, the replacements for the roof on well 1 and 2, and we had a quote from McGuff Roofing, and it came in at $9,300, a quote from Bradley Maintenance came in at $4,800. How do I have my numbers right there? It did not come in for $4.84. No? $4,084. Marv made a motion to approve Brady's because it was basically, as you can see, approximately half the price. And unless you have any other questions.
It was a pretty full meeting.
It was a lengthy meeting. And Derek covered most of the other stuff earlier, and I appreciate him doing that.
Anybody have any questions for John? Okay. Thanks, John.
Thanks, Derek.
Oh, moving right along, unfinished old business. I don't have anything. Do you folks have anything?
I was just looking back through the notes, and I guess follow up with Shadow. What's going on with the dam?
The bids were submitted September 15th, and I have not heard yet on the winning contractor on that. They should have selected that by now. I will say there was some discussion from one of the vendors that was going to, would have been a subcontractor. And I think it brought to light some challenges that may have came out of that, but ultimately they have selected a contractor. I just don't have the name yet. And they should hopefully be starting the work here by the end of October, first part of November.
Yeah, they were, their initial thought was the middle of October, but they're not going to make that, it looks like. They're be a little later than that.
Which, you know, with weather pending, they want the water level down anyway, so if they delay it a little bit more, the water level should be down just a little bit more, make it easier for them. It'll be interesting to see that project.
To watch that project.
It's going to be big.
Okay, under new business, I'd like to thank all of you for letting me go from the meeting last month. Terry Lee and Jim Whitman from the County Council and I went over to East Peoria to meet with one of our Illinois folks who've been interested about Rochester and hopefully relocating to Rochester, his business. The name is Boley Tool and Machine Works, and I mention this now because he'll be in town this Thursday and Friday. Spend 2 days with us, taking a look at sites and just taking a look at Rochester. Our meeting was about 3 hours with him over in East Peoria. It was a good meeting. He's made the statement that he's definitely going to move to Indiana. His corporate taxes 2 years ago over there raised by 42%. It's a long established company, 53 years old, debt-free, has cash reserves, very, very well-heeled company. He's third generation owner, very sharp young man, 53 years old, that's young to me, and knows that if he's gonna continue moving his company forward, he can't do it in Illinois. Hates it. His grandfather, he said, is turning over in his grave, but it is not the same Illinois today it was 53 years ago. So he'll be coming to town. Keep your fingers crossed. He's hoping to parlay not only in this move some business with the orthopedic folks. So we have a meeting with Toby Buck on Friday with this, so he can get to meet Toby with Paragon. And we're going to make our best effort to try and get this gentleman to sign up. His wife's already signed up. She's got two daughters that started at Notre Dame this year, so she could see him every day if she wanted to. Yeah. So thank you for that. That's what's happening on that scene.
You know, how many people do they employ? Did I miss that? I'm sorry.
Oh, no, I didn't mention that. He employs 100 people over there today. We talked about, you know, the particulars of a move, and luckily he doesn't need a building tomorrow. His comment was, if you had a spec building, it probably wouldn't do me any good anyhow, because my thought is I want some things in it that are going to be accepted by the orthopedic industry. So he says, I'm more interested in finding people in your area who have built buildings for those folks to talk about those things. Again, he has not committed. He's coming over on his site visit, but we're going to do everything we can to make it happen. He employs 100 people, and they are pretty nice paying jobs. The move would be academic, though. He would move part of his business, and then the rest of it would come at a time later on so that he didn't disrupt production to his major customers. Biggest customer he has is Caterpillar in Lafayette. And his comment to us was, I'm coming to Indiana, it's either going to be Rochester or Lafayette. I said, whoa, wait a minute. Just because John Garrett went to school down there doesn't mean we need to go there.
Good old gotcha country. You don't want to be too close to everything.
But keep your fingers crossed. Hopefully we can make something to go there.
But see, you should have said John Garrett went to school there and came here to live.
That would have been perfect. That would have been perfect. Now, what I did tell him was, you know, you go to Lafayette, you'll be a dot on their map. In Rochester, you'll be part of a community we're moving forward.
How far away is their current place?
From here? Oh, it's a little over a four-hour drive. It's quite a ways over.
So people would be moving, not commuting, if they were to transfer.
It was wonderful to have Jim Widman along and Terry along also. Terry had some fine points about the workforce that would be available here. He made the comment, you know, I don't know if any of you realize this, but we have about 800 people leaving every day to go to the orthopedic industry. And several of them do things his company does. So there are workers who could be available. Also, the other aspect is good to have Jim Widman along because of his accounting and manufacturing background. This guy had some issues to talk about there, and Jim was just like that in answering them. It was a very good visit. So we hope to keep that momentum going when he comes over here. Okay. ADA concerns? I'm sorry, legal department. Anything on the legal front?
Just one thing. The mayor had asked me to kind of get a little survey in front of the council about what other communities have done with regard to golf cart ordinances. You'll find several communities in there. It varies. Some require the municipal permit. Some don't. Some have a lot more specific. Westfield is in there. Akron is in there. Pretty straightforward. And kind of give you an idea of what is prioritized in some communities, what's going on. Almost all of them specify safety type equipment. And whether it's
Akron has a golf cart ordinance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And, something to mull over between next time. I didn't want to guess which version lean towards until we have further discussions, but some for you to read through.
Yeah, I might add, this has been prompted. I asked Andy to look into this. I had several folks, particularly at the lake, ask about it. We've got people now who've moved in from other places to the lake, and they just automatically bring their golf carts along. Most lake communities have something on that nature. Several years ago, when I was on the council 9 years ago, it came up, but at that time, it was against state law. And now that has changed.
It changed,
right?
Around 2008 or 2009.
Yeah, and communities are going crazy, or they're just doing it one after another. Yeah. So it's something to think about. If you're going to, I look at it this way, if we're going to be a lake community, we probably need to look at things like this.
You better change your speed limits around the lake while you're at it. Because right now people go way too fast around the lake areas.
And the speed limits are 25 miles an hour.
Some of them are, I think there are some areas that might still be 30. But usually 20, 25, 30.
Some of those golf carts will go faster than 25.
Ooh.
Yeah.
But just something to think about this. So make sure we look at the whole picture.
Good point.
I mean, my neighborhood, I mean, we've got tractors, we have lawnmowers, we have golf carts, we have all kinds of crazy stuff in our neighborhood.
And so, where do you live?
Well, in the...
Yeah, Akron.
Yeah, the best one was this. We have, just even around this area, I actually got a complaint, and I made Andy aware of it, that just here, crossing Main Street and stuff, we have some gators, some golf carts. You know, and I just think it's that people don't realize that we currently don't allow those types of vehicles on the streets.
Oh, you're absolutely right.
And yeah. You know, and they need to be I'm totally looking at this as academic and fiscally responsible, is that if we do allow it, I really think we need to seriously look at a permitting process with fees associated to it, just simply because it can be registered, we can keep track of them, we know who has them. Type of thing.
And
may have some other
permitting and
that.
Inspection and the whole night.
Correct. I mean, I just, we want to make sure they have slow moving. I mean, again, it goes kind of like with the chickens. You know, if we're going to look at this, let's look at it holistically and so that we have safety. Because again, and then the permitting and all that stuff, I'm sure if Casey were here, she would say no golf carts, no golf carts, no golf carts, no golf carts coming through her office. So it would, that, with everything
we'd
else,
have to
because
establish,
it's fiscal,
yeah,
or permitting, it all that stuff would come through my office. So
Well, and
maybe we'll get something in the paper.
And then
maybe what?
Maybe we'll get something in the paper. This is a they're not allowed on the street.
Currently not allowed on the street.
Yeah.
Currently not allowed.
West.
And then you know, I was talking to some folks from Indianapolis who have some pretty sophisticated golf carts.
Oh, yes.
You know,
yeah, you can spend
the chief back there, his job would be to, when they're permitted, they'd have to go through a certification of that they've got the lights, they've got the brakes, mm-hmm. turn signals, everything they're supposed to have.
It's actually not Warsaw. I believe it's only Winona Lake.
So I was in Warsaw. Maybe they shouldn't have had it because it was on the Warsaw side.
Okay. Last I understood, I could be wrong, but I know Winona Lake
does. Them.
I'm not sure about.
Yeah, when I was visiting Courtney, my best friend, over on the Warsaw side, her parents live on the Warsaw side, mm-hmm. there was a golf cart that was stalled.
Well, anyway, thank you, Andy, for the research, and that's what it is. Yep. Folks, just research or look at. Okay, I think that brings us down to our ordinances and resolutions. Got ordinance 9-2016, looking at an amendment to portions of our Public Works Water Code backflow.
Derek.
Mr. Derek, what's that all involved?
Basically, we have we have a cross connection ordinance that's in place right now. IDEM has asked us to create our own backflow prevention ordinance, so we have some teeth to pull if we feel that there's any danger to the system. So, having said that, Shada and I worked together and we've got a game plan together, and we sent a copy of that to our IDEM inspector. He approved it, said it looks great, took it to the water board for their approval to send to you guys to approve it, and now it's in your hands.
Okay. We have a copy of that ordinance in front of us. I do. Do you have it?
Just don't lose my copy.
Shut up, I won't lose it. Okay. I would entertain a motion on the first reading of ordinance number 9-2016.
So moved.
Reading in its entirety?
Yeah.
Second?
Second.
Those in favor, raise your hand. Okay. Marty, would you do the honors, please?
Sure.
That's all the
energy
picked
up. Now you know why Brian was ill, right?
Yeah. I'm going to have him call me next time. Ordinance number 09-2016, an ordinance amending portions of the Public Works Water Code concerning backflow prevention. Whereas 675 IAC Article 16, Rule 1.2 of the Indiana Plumbing Code, as adopted by the Indiana Fire Prevention and Building Safety Commission, requires protection of the public water supply from contaminations due to backflow through the connections to fire protection and standpipe systems. And whereas the Indiana Department of Environmental Management authorizes the maintenance of a continuing program of cross-connection control, which will systematically and effectively prevent the contamination of all potable water systems. Whereas the City of Rochester Water Works Board of Directors has recommended following these recommendations and directives of the IFPBSC and IDEM. Whereas the City of Rochester Common Council recognizes the importance of the legislative body supporting public safety. Now, therefore, be it ordained by the Common Council of City of Rochester that the ordinances of City of Rochester are hereby amended as follows, additions listed in bold. Section 52.035, cross connections and backflow prevention. E, that all consumers determined by the Indiana Department of Environmental Management as high hazard by using toxic or hazardous liquids, which includes 1, aircraft and missile manufacturing plants, 2, automotive plants, 3, beverage bottling plants, including dairies and breweries, 4, canneries, packing houses, and reduction plants. 5, car washes. 6, chemical, biological, radiological laboratories, including those in high schools, trade school, colleges, universities, and research institutions. 7, hospitals, clinics, medical buildings, autopsy facilities, morgues, medical facilities, and mortuaries. 8, metal and plastic manufacturing, fabricating, cleaning, plating, and processing facilities. 9, plants manufacturing paper and paper products. 10, plant manufacturing, refining, compounding, or processing fertilizer, film, herbicides, natural or synthetic rubber, pesticides, petroleum products, pharmaceuticals, radiological materials, or any chemical that could be a contaminant to the public water supply. 11, commercial facilities that use herbicides, pesticides, fertilizers, or any chemical that could be a contaminant to the public water supply. 12, plant processing, blending, or refining animal, vegetable, or mineral oils. 13, commercial laundries and dye works, including coin-operated laundromats. 14, sewage, stormwater, and industrial waste treatment plants and pumping stations. 15, waterfront facilities, including piers, docks, marinas, and shipyards. 16, industrial facilities that recycle water. 17, restricted or classified facilities, federal government, defense, or military installations, or other facilities close to the supplier of water or to the commissioner. 18, private water wells connected to the municipal water system. 19, irrigation systems. 20, any other application deemed a risk to the public water supply as determined by the City of Rochester Water Department. F, the reduced pressure principal backflow preventers shall not, excuse me, shall not, this is a long one, Ted.
You need a break?
No, I think I need a backflow filter. The reduced pressure principal backflow preventers shall not be installed below ground level. All reduced pressure principal backflow preventers must be installed in an easily accessible location, not subject to flooding or freezing, as approved by the City of Rochester Water Department. G, that this ordinance does not supersede the Indiana Plumbing Code, the IDEM Rule 327 IAC 8-10, or the City of Rochester Plumbing Ordinances, but is supplementary to them. H, that if in the judgment of the Superintendent of Water, an approved backflow prevention device is necessary for the safety of the public water system, the Superintendent of Water will give notice to the water consumer to install such an approved device immediately. The water consumer shall, at his own expense, install such an approved device at a location and in a manner approved by the Superintendent of Water, and shall have inspections and tests made of such approved devices as required by the Superintendent of Water and in accordance with IDEM Rule 327 IAC 8-10. I, this ordinance shall become effective immediately after adoption on third reading by title only, added by me.
That was added.
I'm sorry, that's not in there. Strike that. The welfare of the City of Rochester requiring.
Okay, thank very good. Thank you, Marty.
Yes, sir.
And of course, you know, for the viewing audience, we have to do that to make this part of the record. You did a fine job. Mrs. Skidmore, third grade elementary class would be proud of you.
Yes, came right through.
Any discussion on this ordinance? I would entertain a reading then by title only of ordinance number 9-2016.
So moved.
Second.
Those in favor, signify. Okay, it's unanimous. Marty, if you would, by title only, please.
Ordinance number 09-2016, an ordinance amending portions of the Public Works Water Code concerning backflow prevention.
Okay, I would entertain a motion for the third reading by title only.
So moved. Second.
So moved. Ryan said so moved and Mason seconded. Those in favor, signify. Okay, unanimous. Marty, by title only, please.
Ordinance number 09-2016, an ordinance amending portions of the Public Works Water Code concerning backflow prevention.
Okay, those in favor of passing ordinance 09-2016,
A motion to approve.
Seconded?
Second.
Those in favor? Okay. There we go. Unanimous. So 09-2016 is passed.
May I please?
She's signing. Look at that. Right ahead.
I'll take you a paper.
She's quite rolling or something.
Yes, yeah, there's some of your signatures on that. You go, Ted.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We have one more ordinance to look at. It's ordinance 10-2016. Again, this is an addition to a current ordinance regarding interference with, it started out as an ordinance that regulates a penalty for interfering with employees of the city or officers in the performance of their duties. What we wanted to add to it was any vendor that is also contracted by the city for city purposes. That we kind of left that door open, and we've had some instances of issues. So that's why this ordinance was updated. I would move for a reading of ordinance number 10-2016 in its entirety.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Second. Second by Chase. Those in favor? It's unanimous. Marty, would you read 20?
Ordinance number 10-2016, an ordinance regarding interference with vendors or contracted persons. Whereas the Common Council of the City of Rochester has determined that certain portions of the city's ordinance regarding harassment of officers and employees of the City of Rochester should be amended to include vendors and contractors. Now, therefore, be it ordained by the Common Council of the City of Rochester, Section 130.06, Rochester Code of Ordinances, is hereby amended to read as follows, additions in bold. It shall be unlawful for any person to interfere with, harass, hinder, or hamper any city officer or employee who is engaged in the official performance of his duties as such, or any vendor, contracted person, or employee, or agent of the same engaged in the performance of a duty owed to the city.
Okay, any discussion on 10-2016? I would entertain a motion for the second reading by title only.
So moved.
Second. Second by Karen. Those in favor, signify. Unanimous. Marty, by title only, please.
Ordinance number 10-2016, an ordinance regarding interference with vendors or contracted persons.
Okay. Entertain a motion for the third reading.
So moved.
By title only. Okay, yes. Second?
Second.
Okay. That was Mason and Chase. Signify by raising your right hand. Okay, Marty, by title only.
Ordinance number 10-2016, an ordinance regarding interference with vendors or contracted persons.
Motion accepting ordinance number 10-2016.
So moved.
Second.
Those in favor signify.
It's unanimous. 10-2016 is passed as rewritten. Thank you. Okay, I have no other business at this time. I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Signify by raising your hand, right hand. We are, thank you back there. It's unanimous. It's unanimous.